glorious motion picture now comes back to the audiences that have paid their tribute in almost unceasing applause. Warner Brothers takes pride in announcing special selected engagements of My Fair Lady.
What about your boast that you could pass her off as a duchess at the embassy ball, eh? I'll say you're the greatest teacher alive if you can make that good. I'll bet you all the expenses of the experiment that you can't do it.
Oh, you're real good. Thank you, Captain.
You know, it's almost irresistible.
She's so deliciously low. So horribly dirty.
Man and arm of iron, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, someone else will do the blinking work.
Welcome to Movie Umpers. My name is Bob Sham.
My name is Angela.
The sound here, probably dogs, or the sound of poverty going from an annoying poor person to an annoying wealthy person, or at least the illusion of one.
And falling in love with a narcissist.
This might be like the worst love story I've ever seen.
It really is.
And even like in the end when we're sealing the deal, it just ends on a joke.
There's not even an embrace.
No, there's no one really learns a lesson at all here.
Yeah.
Except that, you know, she can fake it till you make it, I guess. That's the lesson. Fake it till you make it. All month long, we're talking about musicals and we're in the last stretch. Angela picked all of these.
I did.
And it is we're calling it Raise the Curtain and Belt the Chorus. Musicals all month long. Of a wide variety, and we're going back in more of a classic musical territory, but not a lot of dancing. I wish there was more dancing. Every time there is not a lot of dancing, I kind of wish there was more.
When the older man started kind of shuffling his feet, I saw you kind of raise up a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. He's very old. I thought I actually liked that character.
Yeah, I did too.
This movie's funny.
It is funny.
It's a funny-ass movie.
It's fun. It's just really long.
I feel like I still need to do some studying, and I know people love Audrey Hepburn. She's one of those, like a proto-manic pixie dream girl.
Yeah.
Right? Maybe one in which many after have emulated. She probably invented it, you know?
Maybe, yeah.
Or maybe like Clara Bow or something, you know? Old silent star ladies seem... They kind of got that energy, too.
Yeah, but she's definitely in that lane.
Yeah, yeah. But for me, the jury's still out on Audrey Hepburn.
Agreed.
I don't know if I'm, like, all that entranced by her. I know her character is supposed to be annoying for half this movie, but I was just like, ugh. And I know it's, like, a very much over-deliver kind of thing as well. I understand it's, like, the nature of the type of movie I'm watching, but I just was like, I wish she'd shut the fuck up.
Garn. I ask you, sir, what sort of word is that?
We're talking about My Fair Lady from 1964, directed by George Cukor, written by Alan J. Lerner and George Bernard Shaw, based on Pygmalion, starring Audrey Hepburn, Rex Harrison, Stanley Holloway, Wilfred Hyde White, and many more. Cinematography by Harry Strading, music by Frederick Lowe. This is our second George Cukor movie that we have discussed. Do you remember what the other one is?
No.
Gaslight.
Oh.
Ow.
Gaslight.
Oh.
But I do want to say there is an excellent craft to this movie.
Yes.
Costuming. The set here is unreal.
The blocking of these scenes when there's a street scene where a couple of people will come in and freeze. And then more people will come in and freeze. I like that a lot. I love that. I love the horse race.
Oh, at the Ascot?
Oh, yes. When they're all like, that was very exciting.
Yeah, that
like
was.
It's so good.
That was very funny. But when this movie pulls back into a full setting and you get all these people in their outlandish costumes on both sides of the railroad tracks, the movie actually is quite lovely.
Oh,
and
yes.
And the cinematography of this movie is very good.
Mm-hmm.
It really is just all based upon, I mean, I do think it's a good movie, but I guess compared to what I've been seeing this month, I expected a little bit more than what I got. But I cannot deny how incredibly well crafted this film is for set alone. And yeah, it actually, this is a good movie. That elevates it the most to me.
Absolutely. This movie, it was made the same year as Mary Poppins. It's in that world of Mary Poppins, the Oliver musical, these very larger than life characters. Audrey Hepburn did not sing her own music. She's not a singer. The lady who sang for her is Marnie Nixon. Marnie Nixon. Marnie Nixon has a beautiful voice.
She also did some singing in West Side Story.
And in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, she sang one line that Marilyn Monroe could not sing. There was something that she couldn't hit that Marnie stepped in and did. So this woman was very big deal in the 60s, but you never saw her. So she has this voice. She can play all these characters. She matches to people very well.
So Audrey Hepburn did not sing this, but the annoying Cockney accent is all Audrey.
I loved this so much when I was young. And when I was a kid, it probably just felt like a cartoon because it's so big. But
definitely
watching
has
it
a cartoon
now,
feel. It's a little bit farcical, yeah.
Yeah. It feels she's playing for a stage audience. She's playing for the person in the back row. Didn't need to be that big. It's an audio assault. But it's supposed to be because you're supposed to hate the way she sounds. But it does do that thing where it's complete extremes. She's the most annoying, and then all of a sudden...
Well, she gets taken in off the street. Rex Harrison ends up on this odd part of town where there's shops and stuff.
The king of talk singing, by the way,
the king
Rex
of
Harrison.
Talk singing. And he sings a song. He encounters her. She's got that thick accent. And he explains to her why she's set back in life. And it's all to do with the way she talks. He's like a linguist phonetics guy. So he kind of brags, like, I could turn this lady in. You wouldn't. I could take her to Buckingham Palace. She gave me 6 months with her. But eventually she thinks, like, well, maybe he can, and maybe I can be a flower girl. I could sell flowers in the shop. So she shows up at his house.
Colonel Pinkerton happens to, for some reason, be in that same, in the square at the same time as when he's making fun of and talking about this young woman. And Colonel Pinkerton knows like 130 something Indian dialects, I think.
Yeah, he's a big dialect guy.
And he was like, I came here to meet you. And
Rex Harrison
was like, I was going to go to India to meet you. Come stay at my
house with
me.
Maybe they fell in love off screen.
Well, maybe. The thing that is forgotten in this movie, and they do come back to it at the very, very end, is that she came to him offering to pay him to teach her how to speak better.
Oh, right.
And that is completely forgotten within moments of her living in his house because she is a thing to him.
Yeah.
She is not a person with feelings, and she doesn't do that much to show that she is a person with feelings. Like, she does, but I don't feel as though we really know her hopes and dreams. We know where she comes from.
The colonel and the staff of Rex Harrison's character.
Higgins, Henry Higgins.
They present a more moral side to everything that he's doing. They're kind of trying to keep him level. They are like, yeah, I know she's some cockney girl, but you don't want to be really disrespectful. It's not gentlemanlike, you know?
Yeah, we've seen this a couple of times. Everyone working in the house is like the Greek chorus. They're commentating on what's happening. And at first, they're talking about, yeah, treat her fair, whatever. And then later, it's like, oh, he's such a saint. He's working so hard on this. And then it becomes, fucking get her out of the house. We can't listen to this girl screaming anymore. Because she's sitting there like, ay.
The songs will always provide this description of the characters.
I'm a very gentle man. Even-tempered and good-natured, whom you never hear complain, who has the milk of human kindness by the quart in every vein. A patient man am I, down to my fingertips. The sort who never could, ever would, let an insulting remark escape his lips.
That are not accurate. And it happens multiple times, especially with the Higgins character.
They talk about him like he's a fucking saint and he's an asshole.
Well, it comes off very sarcastic, which is kind of funny.
Poor Professor Higgins. Huh. Poor Professor Higgins. Night and day he slaves away. Oh, poor Professor Higgins.
I actually thought all the comedy bits worked, except when Audrey Hepburn was attempting them.
I know.
I did not laugh at anything that she said or did.
God!
Thought Rex Harrison's timing was good. I thought the way the director captured, like, the snootiness of the high society with the Ascot racing scene.
Everyone who should be here is here. What a smashing, positively dashing, spectacle the Ascot opening day.
I actually thought that was incredibly funny.
I loved his mother because she was definitely part of that world, but she had a heart. And that's what I mean by, I feel like I knew his mom, who was in the movie so little, and I still don't feel like I know Eliza Doolittle.
Yeah.
I don't know her. I know her dad, but I don't know her.
Everyone but her is actually more interesting.
Absolutely. She is a caricature amidst a bunch of people.
With a little bit of luck, you could have a dad as cool as Eliza Doolittle did.
A man was made to help support his children, which is the right and proper thing to do. A man was made to help support his children, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, they'll go out and start supporting you. With a little bit, with a little bit, with a little bit. Work for you.
Let's talk about that hat. What is that?
This hat that doesn't have a brim. It has like a
flop in the back. It looks like it's a broken hat that he just rigged some thing up.
It's so weird. I have no idea why you would wear that hat in practicality.
He's a happy bum, her dad.
Extremely happy. He has his two friends he runs around with, and all they do is drink. He's been dating this woman. He calls her stepmother, but they're not married because he has never been married.
So he does get word where his daughter is at this fancy professor's house, and then he shows up and he's like, you know, I just want five, nothing more. Higgins is so charmed by his rapscallionness, his weird sense of morality.
There's a man for you, a philosophical genius of the first water. Mrs. Pierce, write to Mr. Ezra Wallingford and say that if he wants a lecturer, to get in touch with Mr. Alfred P. Doolittle, a common dustman, but one of the most original moralists in England.
Yes, sir.
There's this person in America who's been wanting him to come speak about something. I don't even know, but wants Rex Harrison, Henry Higgins, to come speak. And it's been annoying him. And his housekeeper is like, you should at least write him back. So he's so tickled by this man and his sense of morality that he tells the housekeeper to write to that man in America and say, if you want an interesting speaker, you should talk to Alfred Doolittle. He's a paragon of
like morality,
low-class morality, yeah, yeah, or something. And the guy calls him because he appreciates Henry Higgins' opinion. He thinks, oh, this must really be a gold mine. Ends up falling for this guy also and leaves him like $4,000 a month for his life and his will.
Yeah,
this guy charms everyone.
So Eliza Doolittle, Audrey Hepburn's rags-to-riches character, she does become good at diction. But there's a point where, and I actually did like this part, where she goes back to her old street,
yes,
to try to find this connection. And a lot of people don't recognize her because she's not dirty and she's got nice, crazy hats on.
Yeah.
But her dad comes out and he's got like a top hat and he's like,
I was happy, I was free. I touched pretty nigh everyone for money when I wanted it, same as I touched him. Now I'm tied, neck and heels, and everybody touches me. A year ago, I hadn't a relation in the world, except one or two who wouldn't speak to me. Now I've 50. Not a decent week's wages amongst a lot of them. Oh, I have to live for others. Nah, not for myself. Middle class morality.
And now everyone, I gotta get married.
Now everyone's coming to me for money to get their drinks. I was happy, and now I'm a middle class man. This is terrible.
Yeah, Henry Higgins has ruined my life. I love that song. I love that whole scene, the get me to the church on time. He's so charming, and this is one of the few times we get dancing.
He's fun. This guy, even though I don't know much about this particular character actor who played her father, he might be approaching my dog territory.
Oh, wow.
I'm feeling doggish about this
guy. Him.
It's a high compliment to an actor or anybody when they become your dog. The jury's still out, but this guy is good dog potential.
I'm playing straight with you. I ain't pretending to be deserving. No, I'm undeserving. And I mean to go on being undeserving. I like it, and that's the truth.
Absolutely. One thing that we must mention is that Eliza came there and was going to pay. But Pickering, the colonel, he bets Henry Higgins that he can't do it, that he can't take her to a ball and pass her off. And that's when, again, she becomes this thing. He speaks about her like she has no feelings. There's this awful scene where they try to give her a bath and she's like, that's indecent. I will not take all my clothes off.
Yeah, it's like,
the same
lady,
time.
Don't you want to? Europeans would like not bathe, though. And this is like turn of the 20th century, maybe.
This is a grown woman who has never been submerged in water.
Yeah.
That's crazy. But there's all these things where they really do. She acts as though she is a dumb kid.
She is completely stupid.
She knows all this stuff, but she's blank. And they even talk about that. She's got this far off look in her eye. When she realizes it is the scene with the rain in Spain stays mainly on the plane.
I think she's got it. I think she's got it.
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain.
By George, she's got it. By George, she's got it. Now once again, where does it rain?
On the plain, on the plain.
And where's that soggy plain?
In Spain, in Spain.
That is a big famous song from this musical also. You know, that's the turning point. What it is he finally sits down next to her and talks to her like a person, which immediately makes her fall in love with him. And she gets very quiet and pensive and she's thinking, and then she actually says, the rain in Spain stays mainly on the plain. And then they start dancing, and then she sings, I could have danced all night. I forgot I could have danced all night was in this show. Because they don't fall in love enough for her to feel that way.
No, there's not. They have a banter, right? It's not completely charmless.
But she's like a little girl or a kid's sister.
No, there is zero romance.
No, there's no charisma.
None.
They're dancing.
Freddie's the guy. Because she meets him at the Ascot and he's completely charmed by her weirdness.
And it's cute when he's giggling, sniggering at her.
And he understands that she's a little weird and a little different, but he doesn't care. Like, Freddie's right there. He's a little stalkery. He won't leave the street where you live, and he even has a song about it.
People stop and stare, they don't bother me. For there's nowhere else on earth that I would rather be. Let the time go by, I won't care if I can be here on the street where you live.
And he doesn't have any money or a job and never will. Because even when she's thinking about getting with him, she's talking about how, well, I'll take care of him. When I make enough money to take care of him, then we'll get married.
He's like a trust fund kid or something, exactly. Right? Whatever. The man loves you, and Rex Harrison's just going to lecture you for the rest of your life. She should be with Freddie, because Freddie appreciates her for what little we see of her.
No, the way this should have ended is she should have done what Rex Harrison, what Henry Higgins suggested at one moment. She should have gone to Colonel Pickering and said, may I have a loan? I want to open my own flower shop, buy a building or a corner of a building where she owns her own flower shop, has an apartment above where she can live, and set up her life. And if she wants to pay Pickering back, if he wants her to, absolutely she'll be able to, because she'll be successful. And don't fucking marry anybody right now, because you don't know what you want. Or where you fit. Make your own way.
Yas, queen. Yas, queen. Yas, queen. Yas, queen. Yas, queen. Yas, queen.
They do eventually go to a ball at Buckingham Palace, and she does amazing. We don't need to split hairs on
that.
The
prince wants to dance with her.
The linguistics guy that's following around. It is a nice scene to look at in terms of costumes.
It's beautiful.
And set. I mean, it's not a bad movie to look at ever.
No.
When they succeed, Higgins is basically like she's no longer in the picture. He won. He won his bet with the colonel. She managed to pass off amongst this high society, even though she comes from nothing. And he doesn't reference her feelings at all. And then at some point he comes back to her after he asks her to do something, and she throws her slippers at him.
Yeah, that scene, I love the blocking in that scene, because some of the servants are in there and they're having a party and congratulating him, and he's telling the story and Pickering's telling the story and they're congratulating each other, and she just gradually goes farther and farther into corner of the room where she disappears a little bit.
In terms of her presence and acting, this part actually was pretty good.
It was great.
Sympathetic to her in that sense. So she takes off.
Two of the other great songs in this movie are Why Can't Women Be Like Men? Song.
Yeah,
and I think that's what she hears, and then she runs away to his mother, and then he comes and visits, right. And he's such a, you feel like you know him, and you even understand where he's coming from, because he makes the point to her, and this reminded me a little bit of somebody, where he said, you say I don't treat you well, but do I treat anybody better? I'm not treating
Are you talking
any,
about me?
I mean, a little bit. Like, okay. I'm not treating anybody any differently. You know what I mean? And also, I'm actually a little nicer to you than I am to other people, but I'm not nice to anyone.
Yeah, the Higgins.
You are very sweet. It's not that. But
no,
just
I'm
the
sweeter
idea,
than Higgins.
You are very much sweeter than
but
Higgins.
But I do understand what he's saying. It's
I did too.
Don't take it personal. I'm just like this.
And then he does when he's missing her, before he goes to get her, he sings the I've Grown Accustomed to Her Face song.
I'm very grateful she's a woman, and so easy to forget. Rather like a habit one can always break.
And yet I've grown accustomed to the trace of something in the air, accustomed to her face.
Which is very sweet, but then again, it's only about her presence and the way she looks. There's nothing about how she is or her demeanor, because again, I don't feel like they know each other, even though they lived together for 6 months. He just misses her being around to pick up his slippers. Even at this point, the one time that she gets fiery is in that scene at his mother's house where she's talking about, I don't need you. And she sings the song about the world will continue without you. As she's getting to the climax of that moment, he jumps up and says, I've done it. You're a woman. You're a fully formed person. And he still is taking all the credit for her coming into her own finally. But that's the thing. Then she leaves and says, you're never going to see me again. He goes home and he's sad. And she just fucking walks in the house and is like, I'm here.
I'll wash my face and hands before I come, I did.
Eliza? Where the devil are my slippers?
Yeah, and that's it.
And that's it. There's no growth.
No.
She said, oh, I'm going to fucking leave you, but she didn't. He takes all the credit but learns nothing.
Yeah, he's funny because his personality is very distinct.
He's such a pouty little baby, too.
Her father's personality is very distinct. The colonel has a very gentlemanly personality that you appreciate. Even Higgins' mother has a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And they're represented better in how kind they are to this person. But the person herself is not really all that deep.
The other person who was up for this role was Julie Andrews. Mm. And as I mentioned earlier, this came out the same year as Mary Poppins. Julie Andrews got passed over for this movie and they gave it to Audrey Hepburn, and then Julie Andrews got Mary Poppins. If she had taken this role, she wouldn't have had Mary Poppins because it was the same time. And she won,
and then probably Robert,
I believe, an Oscar for Mary Poppins.
Probably somebody like a Robert Mitchum would have been Mary Poppins. You know?
That's amazing and ridiculous. I read that in her acceptance speech, she thanked whoever for not casting her in this film. Mm. Because she was fucking Mary Poppins.
It is weird. It almost seems like too much of turn of the century England to have this and Mary Poppins coming out in the same year, right?
Yeah.
It seems like, wow, everyone was just into this era of England at this time.
She is dressed in England. Almost the exact same outfit as Mary Poppins at the beginning of this.
Yeah,
Mary
when
Poppins
she's
is
like
just cleaner.
Sweeping the streets and shit.
Yeah, Mary Poppins is just cleaner.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Well, that is My Fair Lady by George Cukor, a very well-regarded movie. But again, I think it's all about the craft. I'm still on that level of a little overrated when it comes to Audrey Hepburn.
Agreed.
And even just trying to imagine her as like, she just seems like such a, the side of it just seems like a privileged kind of person. Like I can't get that out of my head about her. So to even see her pretend to be some dirty street urchin is like, sure. Right?
Yeah.
You're just like, yeah, this is what we're doing, I guess. Right?
There's also a charm to this movie wherein it's completely obvious that they're on a soundstage the whole time.
Well,
I kind of like that.
The staging is my favorite part. It's beautiful.
Absolutely. It's
undeniable,
beautiful.
Masterful.
Yes.
Masterful. So we're going to give this 1 through 5 each combined for best out of 10. When I think about the craft of the movie itself, and a lot of the characters are good. I think Rex Harrison is quite good in this. The story I just feel a little more middling on.
Mm-hmm.
And I was settling at a 3.5, but to be fair with how well made this is, I got to go to a 3.75.
I'm going to give it a 4.
Kind of sounded like we didn't like it, but it managed to have an A-. There was just a specific element we were bothered by. But ultimately, My Fair Lady by George Cukor from 1964, an A movie, an A- at the bottom of the A's in between the films Jericho,
Paul Robeson
movie, and Jordan Peele's Nope, the crafty little alien scare movie. So yeah, My Fair Lady, that's where it is. But yeah, I think a lot of people would go S tier on this, but you go wherever you want to go, you know, wherever you want to go. The next movie we discuss, it's a packed week this week, leading into Thanksgiving, But tomorrow, come back and we will be discussing A Chorus Line into some 80s era musicals. All right. And like, subscribe, check the show notes, links for other places to find us. Leave a comment. Let us know what you think of My Fair Lady. How are we right? How are we wrong?
Happy Thanksgiving. Everybody, yeah.